So first talk today is ARI management. So we need to know about little bit of ARI because we are dealing with in ICU patients as well as emergency patients and also in the ward. You need to identify when the ARI is compromised. Okay, so those patients are very, it can land up into grave situations at times. So ARI assessment is, you need to know the basics, some basic things. Okay, so first thing is to recognize the sign of a threatened ARI, and then to this we'll describe about how to deal with a threatened ARI patients, and also we need to know some about the ARI adjunct devices. Okay, and regarding intubations, we will tell some points as well. Okay, so these are the headlines over which I will talk about in the next couple of minutes. So the ARI is coming the most important way, because in all the settings like emergency, general wards, radiology suites, intervention lab, in those areas, especially the radiology suites, intervention labs, you may not have the your support system. Okay, sometimes suction devices are not available, sometimes you will find that the proper blade is not available, the laryngoscope blade is not working, so you will end up in a very difficult situation. And in those situations, how to manage a ARI, difficult ARI, or a threatened ARI, we will discuss all these things today. Okay, and during the transport also, often we have not adequate ARI adjunct along with us, so that most of the time we often have difficulties to manage any problem. Once the patient is like, many times it happens that during transport your ARI is lost. Okay, the tube is dislodged from the, so you have to intubate or maintain the ARI oxygen saturations and maintain the ventilations during that period. So this is something can land up into grave situation, and the patient can die also. Obviously intensive care unit also points where the maximum patients are very sick patients, they have comorbidities, so those patients have any difficult, well, the scenario is something like that, sometimes we face difficult ARI, so we need to have all the ARI adjuncts along with us, so that we could save the patient life in case of any threatened ARI. So let's see a case scenario. First, a obese man coming in the emergency with severe respiratory distress, and see the respiratory rate is around 40, saturation is 88 with high flow oxygen. So already patient is on high flow oxygen and respiratory rate is very high. So as from the yesterday's talks, we know that respiratory rate is a early marker of any difficulty. So there may be, we don't know the pathology of the lung, okay, here, but we definitely know that this patient needs attention. Okay, so respiratory rate is high, saturation is low even with high flow oxygen, then that means something is, the patient have oxygenation, it we can easily say that patient is hypoxemic respiratory failure here from this point, and the patient is using accessory muscles. Okay, and confused, some orientation problem is also there, so this patient needs some attention. So does this patient need intubation, and how do you assess the respiratory system of this patient, and definitely the ARI status? So we usually go by ABC, any patients ABCDE, this is the protocol. Okay, so if you look at the ARI first, we see that there is the division is upper ARI as well as the lower ARI. Upper ARI start from the nasal nares, okay, and it's up to the basically a precoid cartilage from here up to these things, and below that we usually call the trachea, and the below portion we call it a lower ARI, which basically have tracheobronchial tree, and ultimately it's end up in the alveoli. Okay, this is the lower ARI part. So first thing is that any threatened ARI, we have to understand ARI assessment is to be there, whether this ARI is threatened or not. So first see whether the patient is taking spontaneous breathing or not. If the breathing is there and the chest expansion is there and the patient consciousness, the patient is conscious or not. Because if the patient is unconscious, what will happen? The tongue will fall down. Most of the time, why we put the nasal airway or oral airway? Because the basically once the patient is loses his consciousness, two things happens. One is the fall of the tongue and another is the pharyngeal wall, that the muscle tone is lost. So this is the collapsible pharyngeal tone. So pharyngeal muscle, if it drops down, so it will be close this the behind the tongue. Okay, so there will be no passage of, even if the patient's airway is patent downwards, the patient will not able to take the proper respirations. Brain is slightly okay, some confused, but still he will not be able to take proper breathing. Okay, so sense frame is one important part. Another is the patient spontaneous breathing is there or not, or the patient sometime may be in apneic state because of any brain pathology. Okay, and chest expansion is good or not, you have to see, because in sometime trauma patients or patient may have some one-sided pneumothorax or any hemothorax, that time one side will be moved or the other side will not move. Okay, and breath sound, you have to auscultate the with the stethoscope that both side equal air intake is there or not, and normal breathing sound is not there or not, whether one side is decreased breath sound or not, that is most important. If it is decreased, something may be the lung has collapsed. The breath sound has its character. So breath sound, if it is not there, absent, that means there is nothing, maybe air or maybe fluid, that is blood. Most of that in trauma setting, it will be hemothorax. Okay, one side the the chest cavity is filled with blood. Okay, and sensorium, one more important, as I told, that protective airway reflexes. Once the patient is drowsy, the whole of the oral secretions will be pulled up in the hypopharynx, and ultimately it will trickle down to the trachea as well as in the lung and will cause aspiration pneumonia. This is the most common cause in, that's why in low GCS status, usually below 8, we tend to intubate those patients or do tracheostomy to protect the airway. Okay, and another important thing in trauma setting is the whenever we check any airway, yesterday also I told that the check airway or some any assessment, we should take care of the cervical spine, because cervical spine is the upper cervical spine, there is the respiratory center up there. So if we manipulate it, the odontoid, this C2, that vertebra odontoid process may damage the upper cervical cord as well as the medulla portion, and the patient can suddenly die in front of you. So you have to take care of this spine, in especially in trauma patient. And also not only trauma, sometimes the patient with rheumatoid arthritis, those patients have subluxations and some problem are there. So if you manipulate directly, and severe osteoporosis patient as well, they can have the similar problem. Okay, so and the other signs of, you have to see for airway obstruction sign, that is partial obstruction, what will happen? Some sound, gurgling sound will appear, like noisy breathing, labored breathing, some stridor. If stridor, usually in the upper airway obstruction, and in the lower part usually the wheeze, that is in the bronchospasm in COPD or asthma patient we see. Okay, so these are all the airway assessment way, whether the airway is patent or not. Okay, so how to maintain the airway patency? So we have to do some maneuver, we'll show how to do it. Okay, so check the airway patency and assessment, as I told before. Okay, and clear airway. If there is any secretion, blood or pulled up, you have to do suction. There are suction devices are there, you can do. If it is very thick, you do Yonkers, that's the plastic rigid one, you can do. And sometimes the steel, it made of steel metal also, that can be also used. Okay, and as I told, during suctioning or any airway assessment, you should protect the cervical C spine. Okay, and open the airway, there are different maneuver there, I'll show. Okay, and whenever there is patient sensorium is down and you are suspecting the tongue fall or the pharyngeal collapse, we can use to bypass that either nasopharyngeal airway or oropharyngeal airway. But one you must know that appropriate size has to be given. If you give a smaller size, it will further, it will worsen the scenario. I'll show how it is happened. So this is how you will do the manual inlay stabilizations. So your hand, one person will stabilize this holder, and another person will hold this mastoid process. Okay. Other person will, this mastoid process, one, two hand will be there, two hand will be there, and this is like, and hold the other side of this head, okay, and the, this occiput should be touch on the hardboard, okay. And if this patient need intubations, the other third person from the side will intubate the patient, okay, from the right side. So 3 person will be required, obviously one more person if the drug has to be given, okay. So how to open the airway? Basically head tilt and chin lift, but it is C spine trauma, we don't do it, okay. Only jaw thrust can be done, that also with manual inlay stabilization first you have to do. So again here the tongue fall, you see the tongue fall, tongue, once the tongue is falled here, tongue is fault here and causing obstruction of the patency. So by oral airway you have to see appropriate size, how they are taking the appropriate size from the angle of the mouth to ala of the, sorry, the this ear tragus, tragus to this ala of the mouth, angle of the mouth, okay. This is nasopharyngeal airway, how this nasopharyngeal airway is measured, appropriate size, this ala of the nose to this angle, this angle, okay. So bag and mask ventilations, when the patient is, you don't have any definitive airway, first thing is a ventilation management by simple resuscitator, that is the ambu bag, okay, and along with the mask you can maintain the ventilation, as well as along with, if you add the oxygen, the oxygen port is there with a reservoir, it can give up to 90% and some over to 95% oxygen can be given with this. This is a non-rebreathing type of basically ventilations can be given through the, through this ambu bag. So one person technique, and this is the holding the mask is two type, you can hold it like C or you can hold it like E technique, okay, by how the fingers are there over the face. So if it's two person is there, like heavy jaw, so in that case one person with one hand holding, it's not possible to ventilate. So the person will concentrate on the holding the mask, the other person will give the breath. So this is how the two hand technique, how you hold the mask, okay, and jaw, if you jaw lift or jaw thrust has to be given, so that the tongue goes up and the it doesn't obstruct the posterior pharyngeal wall. So where the condition where we put the definitive airway? Definitive airway by putting the endotracheal tube. So in case of cardiac arrest, in case of any trauma patient, when trauma patient is apneic or loss of airway patency there, or in the medical cases when the patient is apneic or any loss of airway patency in case of perioperative scenario as well. So any respiratory failure, severe hypoxemic failure, severe ventilatory failure which is not controlled with the BiPAP or non-invasive ventilation, go to the invasive ventilation, okay. So intubation trolley, what should it contain? It should contain the first thing, the oxygen, suction, and the equipments for the intubations, okay. Oxygen, suction, and all the instrument for the intubation, that is the laryngoscope, tube, suction, okay. Another thing is the bougie, another thing is what? Okay, so you need the other drug, medicines, okay, medicine to sedate the patient, because if the patient has a severe reflexes, he will not open his airway, he will not open the mouth, so you have to give some amount of sedations. So some drug has to be given in the form of IV and to sedate the patient before you intubate. Otherwise in neuro patients, you should not intubate without proper sedation, because unless if you try to intubate and fight with the patient, what will happen? The brain pressure will rise and the patient will die during your intubation. Okay, patient was okay, but you try to intubate the patient because the GCS is low and the patient died during intubation. This happens many times because you are not properly doing the intubation. Intubation is not like just the putting the tube. It's not a fight. Okay. You have to do it in a logical manner. Okay, what is needed? So everything should be prepared beforehand. Your plan should be very clear. You should not just jump on to tube, put the tube. In case of emergency, we do it often, like in CPR scenario, the patient is totally apneic and going to die. That is a different scenario. But whenever it is a planned intubation, everything should be ready and it should not be hasty. You should give a proper sedation. At times you will give the proper relaxant. So the patient will be relaxed and you will easily intubate the patient. So the sniffing position is the best position for the laryngoscopy. So you will able to see the vocal cord. This is for the intubation position. Okay. So what we usually put a pillow. Okay. Pillow over the head and sometime in the shoulder blade in case of very obese patient. We keep a ram positions. This is how we do. If we want to do this intubation, we will not be able to visualize any part of the larynx. So what we'll do? We'll put in some pillows and below the shoulder blade as well to keep a ram positions so that this we'll able to see some part of the larynx. Okay. So these are the different blade. One is curved blade, that is Macintosh, and the straight blade we call it Miller blade. The doctor will just give me the Miller blade. So you don't know what is Miller, what is Macintosh. Macintosh is curved one and Miller is straight one. Okay. So whenever there is the very big epiglottis, they are not able to visualize, that time sometime we use the Miller blade. Otherwise most of the time Macintosh is the okay. We don't need any, it's about the expertise of the who is doing the intubations. Okay. But for adult usually five size blade is there. Blade at different sizes are there. Okay. So in usually in female 3 to 4 size is okay, and for male it is 4 to 5 size of the blade you have to use. Okay. So this is Macintosh, this is Magill or sometimes Miller blade we can say. So this is how we see in laryngoscope view. This is the view of the vocal cord. So you can see, if you are lucky enough, you will see this picture and then easily intubate. But most of the time we see this one or this one. Okay. So it's difficult. So you need it is very difficult. Airway is not just a, so you should, everything should be ready for. So most of the time we use bougie for these two things. We put the bougie and over that we railroad the tube. So see, this is the type. Okay. So if it is very difficult, you should not poke the with the tube and causing bleeding over there. Then what will happen? That will go edematous and you will not be able to intubate it further. So it's better you do one or two times attempt, and then if it is not possible, you just leave it and the patients will you continue the ventilation with the ambu bag or the bench circuit, whatever is available. But you leave that point of time and this oxygenation or the ventilation can be managed with basically ambu or bench circuit, and then once patient awakens, the patient will be able to respire on its own. Okay. So this is the tube. This is the cuff portion we inflate through this thing. So appropriate size of tube is there. If the patient is adult and you are putting the 6 side tube, even if full inflation, the patient will leak. There will be leak around the cuff. That day I was taking the ventilation, how the leak will be there, the gap between the time inspired and the time expired. So if there is a gap is too much, first thing you have to see whether the cuff is properly inflated or not. But you should not do too much of cuff inflation should not be there. The pressure gauge is there, we can measure it. 20 to 25 is the centimeter of H2 should be there. Okay, maximum 30 centimeter of H2 you can keep the cuff pressure. Okay. So intubation bundle, we know that we need two operator here. Okay, we need to post intubation, most of the patient will land up into some hypotension. So you need some fluid loading and give some sedation, and before that you need to pre-oxygenate the patient, because during intubation the patient will be hypoxemic. So you have to some pre-oxygenate. Okay. So intubation usually in ICU setting or emergency setting we do it. That is RSI technique. That is rapid sequence intubation. So it's done very quickly. You should not take and then here and then take time and then intubate. You have to do it very fast. Maybe below 20 seconds. Okay. Ideally 10 second or 15 second you should take, not more than that. And some Selig maneuver we do, because if the sometime we do rapid intubation, the patient is got fear also. So what we do some compression here over the cricoid to prevent, to compress the esophagus so that any gastric content does not come out through the to mouth and not ultimately spillage to the airway. So we don't want that. So we do Selig maneuver during intubation in the ICU. Ideally you should do Selig maneuver. But often you do not do, I think. So you should give a pressure on the cricoid with a like 1 kg pressures or up to 3 kg pressures. I don't know how it is done, but it is like a adjustment, like when your nail is getting blanched sort of things. It has been studied that 10 to 30 kg will be okay. So post intubation you need to monitor the patients. Patient may go into noradrenaline because of hypotension occurs, and you have to put the patient on lung protective ventilation that I told, that 6 ml per kg low tidal volume ventilation. So principle of suctioning, first next thing is that your suction catheter should not be more than the 50% of the airway. So like it is a 7 or 8 millimeter size tube, so 3 into 8 basically is so 8 millimeter internal diameter. Okay. So your suction catheter usually in that case, I think 8 millimeter internal diameter. So what we'll do, suction catheter, how much maximum we can go? How much? Usually French, if you divide the 3, like 14 or 16 suppose, so if you divide by 3, that millimeter will come. Like if it is 16, like suppose it is 15 French catheter. So if you divide, that will come a 5 millimeter. So but 8 and 5, it is less than, more than 50%. So you should not use a little lesser, because unless in that case, what will happen if you use larger size of catheter through the tube, it will obstruct the airway. And sometime during, if the breath is also given or some in a closed suction catheter, it can cause sudden airway pressure and pneumothorax can, patient lung can rupture. So pneumothorax can occur. Okay. Definitely you have to pre-oxygenate, and that suction mode quick access I told yesterday, before oxygen will be automatic will be 100%, and post also some part of time it will be 100% oxygen. So RSI, rapid intubation always in emergency scenario is RSI, rapid. You have to give some sedation and sometime the relaxant as well, very short acting, like succinium, succinyl choline we give, or it can rocuronium. These two drug usually commonly given, and everything should be prepared beforehand, and then we intubate, and sometime we give this cricoid pressure to prevent the gastric aspiration. Okay. So RSI technique we commonly use, and definitely in pregnant patient as well as some abdominal cases we do same thing. This is the cricoid pressure, how it is given, the cricoid pressure to obstruct the esophagus. So RSI I already told, nothing. So difficult airway, basically something we anticipate, if we assess something that patient is difficult airway, we have a plan. So we do plan beforehand and accordingly we act. Okay. But in sometime we have unanticipated with airway difficulty. So in that scenario we'll end up in a very difficult situations. What to do at that point of time? So it is always suspect that if you that something may have problem while you intubate. So every adjunct should be there in your hand to save the patient life. So difficult airway is the, it can have in different scenario, by difficult laryngoscopy or difficult max ventilations or difficult intubation. At any point of time you may face difficulty. So for each type you need to assess that, for first thing to assessment, to in which part of the I may get difficulty, and accordingly the plan has to be there in your mind as well as also in your preparation should be there. So difficult face masks, laryngoscopy or tracheal intubations, and you will end up into failed intubation at times. So it's a very common thing. Most of the time we have facing difficulty in max ventilations, mostly in very heavy jaw, edentulous, obese patients, okay, massive large tongue, the OSA patients, those patients with difficulty have max ventilation. So what we can do, we can do some airway devices like oropharyngeal, nasopharyngeal airway, then ventilate, or sometime one person will hold dedicatedly the max ventilation, the other person will give the bed. That times by two hand technique, as I saw in the pictures previously, okay. So that can be used here. So difficult laryngoscopy is okay. So experience, many times we face that, saw the picture, if you are lucky enough you will see the whole of the larynx and you will intubate, but most of the time it is not there. So difficult laryngoscopy we face many times. So what we will do, you have some assessment, but we will not go, it's many part of the mainly anesthesia MD course. So I am not going into that. But one thing is, if you show the jaw movement should be there, and mouth opening should be at least 3 finger width. These two things you just remember, okay. Mouth opening and this jaw movement, these two things, if it is okay, and if you have the neck movement, neck flexibility, if it is there, so that we can easily intubate the patients. These three part, okay. So this is how we assess basically this jaw movement, okay, and the mouth opening, this 3-3-2 basically that's showing. These are not required, okay. So this is how mouth opening, if you are able to see, this is the intubations for this one, this is most difficult, okay. So airway component, this is not required for you people. Difficult fail intubations problems, yes, ICU patients we have difficulty because the patients mostly are many comorbidities, they are already unstable, they have already in shock scenario, already saturation is low. Now if you want to intubate and take some time, the patient will be hypoxic, and then you saw that no sir, heart rate is going down, patient is going to arrest, please ventilate, give oxygen. So you don't have any time, you have to do it very fast, maybe 10-15 second you will get time to intubate. So always in ICU, whenever one person is intubating, if a junior doctor is intubating, you always inform your senior doctor that that someone is intubating, sir, maybe face some difficulty, and always keep ready all the equipments like the bougie and all these things, okay. So emergency setting is always, you see, it is a difficulty. Just regard is, this is a difficult airway, we have to plan everything, okay. So difficult airway cut, so all what should be there in your cut, okay. So suction, first thing is the suction, all type of airway, various type of marks, various type of laryngoscopy plate, rigid blood, the tube, the style, that bougie, and the there are several adjuncts are there, we will not go into that, at least LMA, okay, and combi tube, these are should be there, and if you have the FOB, that also can be as a part of the difficult airway cut. So you have to prepare, basically what I mean to say, all the things should be there in the premises. So ventilations, for different difficult ventilations we usually put the airways and then ventilate, okay, oral airway, or we can appropriate size of marks. Difficult intubations, we can use the different type of blade, we can use the bougie, we can use sometimes LMA as a conduit to put the tube, and sometimes the fiber active intubations as well, okay. So plan, different plans should be there, we should have a plan, one, two, if we fail, do not able to intubate just directly, what should we do? If you again in second step we failed, what to do? So everything should be planned in your mind, okay. This is all anticipation and planning. So first things, if we failed, if we succeed on the, that is okay, then you intubate it. But if you failed, what to do? You should have LMA, you can try with LMA. Now LMA, it is ventilating, oxygenating, then also it is okay. But if you fail with the LMA, what will do? You have to back to the face masks on, then ventilate with either with the Benz circuit or the AMBU itself. Again we fail, we can try once more the LMA, and otherwise we will have to AVOC the patient. By that time the patient may be AVOC with your sedations, then it is very good. If it is not, then it is very difficult. If the hypoxia is occurring, then either emergency airway or cannula cricothyrectomy, with putting a cannula in the cricothyroid membrane, or the surgical cricothyrectomy. okay, but it should not happen to this level, but you should be prepared with all that so that it can be managed up to plan C, okay, not you will end up in a scenario with plan D, okay. So this is how some BARP maneuver, we give some pressure, we ask some, give some pressure so that we can see the, this is called basically well optimal external laryngeal manipulations to see the better laryngoscopic view, okay. So this is gum elastic bogey to help, we basically in case of difficult view, what do we do in grade, that grade 2 and 3 cases we put the bogey and then we reload the tube. So these are different other bogey sort of introducer. So plan B basically LMA, if we fail during laryngoscopy we go in the LMA, different type of LMA. Plan C when we fail basically we back to the airway device, that's ventilation, okay, face mask ventilations, okay. So if we fail the plan C basically cannot intubate, cannot ventilate situation, that time patient is deteriorating, we don't have any, we have to put the non invasive some combi tube is there, or you can go by direct cannula kickotherectomy or surgical kickotherectomy. I will show just picture, combi tube is you just put, you don't have to see where it is going, just put inside the mouth. There is two port here actually, one will go into the trachea, if it is not it will go to the esophagus, but in between some hole are there, in between here some hole are there, we have a two port here na, so where it is go, wherever it is, maybe esophagus or maybe trachea, but if it is in the trachea then we can ventilate through this one, if it is going in the esophagus we can ventilate through this one. So this is a combi tube, we can ventilate the patients, okay. Here actually picture is there, the air is coming through these ports, some 6 to 8 ports are there. So this is how, so plan C, D as I told, emergency, that is cannula cricothyrectomy or surgical cricothyrectomy, this is not I think required, this is where the cricothyroid movement, this thyroid cartilage and cricoid cartilage, this is the gap, it may be 1.2 to 1.5 centimeter, this is enough area, we can do the tracheostomy as well from that. So then surgical cricothyrectomy actually we put the smaller size of tracheostomy tube through that membrane. Cannula I think it's not required, nowadays it is not being done, rather than emergency surgical cricothyrectomy where we put basically through a dissection and then immediately cut the skin and then this slight dissection you will go into the larynx itself. So you will put the tracheostomy tube here. See. Just if you give incision, this one, this horizontal, and then some dissection, you will go into that. So this is how. So take home message: it's airway in ICU is definitely it's a challenging thing. So you have to assess the patient properly. What is the problem? And you have to think everything and plan in advance. So all plan A, B, C, D plan has to be in your mind, and accordingly the preparation has to be made, okay. So don't try too much of intubation, 3 good attempts is okay, because if you try and then the bleeding occurs then it is very difficult for the, your senior will not able to intubate after that. So if you try 1 or 2 times, maximum 3 times, but you should not make injure the area, laryngeal area, okay. So if you have trouble, better you somehow ventilate the patients with bag and masks and then awaken the patient, that is better. So we should not play with the patient live, and muscle relaxation should be used very cautiously, because if you are not sure that you could be able to intubate the patient, in that case muscle relaxation is very dangerous at times, okay. So the ultimate goal is to provide oxygenation and ventilation to the patient, okay. So this, thank you.